I'm Dr. Ben Weinberg. I'm a gastrointestinal medical oncologist at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital. I specialize in the treatment of patients with colon and pancreatic cancers. We administer a variety of different treatments. The treatment we're probably most well known for is chemotherapy, but we also administer targeted therapy and immunotherapy. So we sort of form the quarterback of the team that takes care of patients with cancer. So we work closely with radiation oncologists, surgeons, gastroenterologists, pathologists, and a variety of other support staff to help our cancer patients. We used to tell people, you know, wait 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, a year, and a new treatment will become available. And it used to take much longer than that. Now the field is moving so quickly, it's almost hard to stay on top of all the advances that we're having. And those advances have basically come in one of two forms. One is immunotherapy, and immunotherapy works by training your body's immune system to take care of the cancer itself. And the other is targeted therapy. If we can figure out the mechanisms by which the cancer cell divides and grows, we could be able to stop the cancer cell in its tracks if we can find drugs that target those mechanisms. We have a couple benefits at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital. One is our team. So we have excellent surgeons, excellent radiation oncologists, excellent gastroenterologists who are really leaders in the field. And we work together as a team to come up with treatment plans that are best for patients. The other thing is we're on the cutting edge of different research strategies. So immunotherapy clinical trials and targeted therapy clinical trials. So treatments that we think are promising but are not yet FDA approved to treat cancer, we have access to those drugs here. And if appropriate, we can get patients on those trials. Being at MedStar Georgetown University Hospital, we definitely operate in the pursuit of cura personalis, so treatment care of the whole person. So not just focusing on their cancer, but what effects the cancer is having on their body, what effect the treatment is having on their body, other psychosocial issues that we tend to not spend as much time talking about, but trying to focus on those when it's critically important for our patients. There's nothing better than to feel like you've really benefited a patient's life, and especially if that results in something like a cure. We often don't know for quite some time whether a cure is truly a cure, so a lot of what we do is monitor patients very closely after they finished whatever treatment, not only to make sure that they're truly cured, but to see what side effects of the treatments can crop up later on in life. So there's a lot of aspects to survivorship that are critically important to manage. But that feeling, that sensation, is truly rewarding. We offer a whole panoply of different treatments. I mean, the old standard is different forms of chemotherapy. Those are drugs either in IV or pill form, which work on rapidly dividing cells, the theory being that the most rapidly dividing cells in the body are cancer cells. So those drugs are typically not smart bombs, they're sort of dumb bombs, but they work by killing rapidly dividing cells. And we still use them, even though some of them have been around for decades, because they're effective and we know their side effect profiles and they're pretty manageable. We also have newer therapies like immunotherapy. And how immunotherapy works is basically by retraining your body's own immune system to go and attack the cancer. A lot of times we have immune cells in our body that are ready, willing, and able to go kill cancer cells, but for whatever reason, the cancer has turned themselves off to the immune system, put the immune cells to sleep, and we now have drugs that can re-energize or reinvigorate tumors, immune cells to go after and kill the tumor cells. And then the other treatment we have are different forms of targeted therapy. So through better knowledge of how tumor cells grow, we know certain pathways, certain mechanisms by which tumor cells can grow and divide. And we now have drugs that can exploit those pathways by shutting them down. So if we can identify certain pathways that we can target with a novel drug, we may be able to stop a cancer cell in its tracks. And oftentimes what we're doing is combining those therapies together, so chemotherapy, immunotherapy, and targeted therapy. We also work closely with a number of our colleagues throughout the hospital to offer local therapies. So what I've mentioned so far are systemic therapies. They go everywhere throughout the body. We also have local therapies that can go in and treat cancer cells where they are. One is surgery, so cut out the cancer if it's available to do so. One is radiation, so deliver some focused radiation to kill the cancer cell where it lies. And then we also work with interventional radiologists who can do local procedures to inject tumors, ablate tumors, even biopsy tumors to get us more information. There's a variety of also therapies we work a lot with to inject drugs, including chemotherapy, radiation, directly into the liver to kill tumors that are trying to grow in the liver. I often see patients after they've already been diagnosed with colon or pancreatic cancer, and I think it's important a lot of times patients want a second opinion. So they often see an oncologist in the community who gives them sort of standard of care options. I think it's important, you know, for them to come to see us so we can review their scans, their pathology, their treatment course, recommend certain standard of care options, but also see if we have clinical trials available for that patient. And so we work closely with our fellow community physicians to figure out, you know, what patients are best treated in the community, what patients should come here. Often it's, you know, the patient preference, but a lot of times we try to get patients back to the community so they can get treatment closer to home. The good news is overall rates of colorectal cancer incidence are actually on the decline, and that's largely due to the advent of colonoscopic screening in the older patient population started in the late 80s. The sad part is we're actually seeing a rise in young onset colorectal cancer. So this is the population that's under 45, that's too young to get a routine surveillance colonoscopy if they're at average risk for developing colorectal cancer. And this is a relatively recent phenomena. The incidence really started increasing in the 90s, and the rate of death from colorectal cancer in younger patients has started increasing since the year 2000. And we don't really know why this is occurring. There's a lot of theories that it has to do with rises in rates of obesity, diabetes, something we eat in our diet. But to be honest, we really don't know the answer. So this is a field of very active research to try to figure out why young patients are getting colon cancer. There's a variety of theories out there. One is obesity, one is diabetes. But I will tell you, our clinic is filled with young patients with colon and rectal cancer who are neither obese nor diabetic. So something is clearly going on. One of our theories is it has to do with microbiome. So you have about a trillion cells in your body. You have a trillion, probably trillion and a half cells in your gut, which are bacteria, most of which we don't really know exactly what they do. We know some are good. They help us digest foods. We know some are bad. They can cause disease, cause infections. And we actually now know that some can actually cause colon and rectal cancers. And so one of our research interests is to try to see, is the microbiome, both in the gut but also in the tumor itself, different in patients with young onset colorectal cancer and older onset colorectal cancer? So we have a grant from the Colorectal Cancer Alliance looking at young versus older onset colorectal cancer, specifically looking at the intratumoral microbiome, meaning the bacterial DNA that are present in the tumor tissue as opposed to what's found throughout the gut. And we're hoping to demonstrate some sort of difference that would, one, shed light on what's causing these cancers to develop, may actually allow us to develop novel therapies, including antibiotics and vaccine therapies, to target those bacteria, and then also might inform us to how to best screen these patients. Should everybody get colonoscopies at 45, 40, 35? What if we could do it in a smarter way where we can identify patients with a high-risk stool, for example, via stool sample, and then say that patient should get a colonoscopy much earlier, or they could get routine colonoscopy at 45 or older. So those are the types of things we're trying to unlock through this research. I have a specific research interest in young onset colorectal cancer. So I have a trial looking at the microbiome or the bacterial within the tumor itself in patients who were diagnosed before age 45 and those who were diagnosed after age 65. So I'm trying to capture as many patients as possible to try to answer this question: is the bacteria within the tumor different in young versus older onset colorectal cancer? So I encourage all young onset colorectal cancer patients to come here so that we can do those types of testing. The other reason to come here is for a second opinion, to figure out, am I getting the right treatment? Should we switch to something else? Is there a clinical trial available? You have a trillion cells in your body. You have a trillion to probably trillion and a half cells in your gut, and that's what we refer to as the gut microbiome. And those are mostly bacterial cells, many of which we don't know exactly what they do. We know some are good. They help us digest foods. We know some are bad, can cause disease like infections. And we now know that some can actually cause cancer, specifically colorectal cancer. And we think of the microbiome as an interplay between the immune system, the environment, like your diet, and genetics, so what you've inherited from your parents. And this is important not only for risk of disease and things, but they've actually shown for immunotherapy, a drug we use a lot of, different bacteria in your gut can actually change how well your cancer responds to immunotherapy. So that's a sort of separate interest from my interest, which is mainly looking at what bacteria are within the tumor. But a lot of oncologists are interested in bacteria throughout the gut because it may actually impact how patients respond to therapy. And if patients aren't responding to immunotherapy, maybe we should be giving things like antibiotics, probiotics, even stool transplants to maybe alter the microbiome. A lot of that research is still ongoing right now. We used to refer to colorectal cancer as one entity, and once a cancer spread outside the colon or rectum, we treated them as the same cancer. It's a colon cancer that spread to the liver, a rectal cancer that spread to the liver. They're one, you know, cohesive entity. But we now know through doing a lot of studies of tumor DNA profiling, so taking tumor tissue, sequencing out the DNA to find the mutations that cause that cancer to grow, we now know there actually are significant differences in tumors that come from what we call the right side of the colon, which is closer to the liver, the left side of the colon, which is closer to the rectum, and the rectum itself are all sort of discrete different pockets of cancer. And those mutational patterns kind of change throughout the colon and also change as patients age. So we know that younger patients, for example, tend to get colon cancers more in the rectum or near the rectum, whereas older patients tend to get cancers in the colon that are closer to the liver. And this is actually important because it impacts response to certain treatments for patients with advanced disease. Immunotherapy is designed to retrain your body's own immune cells to go after and attack the cancer. There are some cancers that have basically put up a force field to the immune system. They've developed ways to escape our immune cells, which normally go and kill bacteria or other bad things the body finds. So there are certain handshakes that some cancers have where they can shake the hands of the immune cell and say, "You don't need to attack me, you can just go to sleep." And that immune cell will go to sleep. We now have drugs that can disrupt that handshake and can say, no, the tumor cell can't turn the immune cell off anymore. Now the immune cell is awakened and can actually go out and find and kill the cancer. Immunotherapy is more or less effective in different types of cancers. And even in the cancers where it's effective, it doesn't seem to work for all patients. And why that is, we're still trying to figure out. What we do know is that the more mutations or the more irregular your tumor is, the more susceptible it is to immunotherapy. And the best examples of that are melanoma skin cancer, which often develops from ultraviolet light radiation. That radiation doesn't cause some changes to the tumor cell, it causes lots of changes. It disrupts the DNA of the tumor cell. And more DNA disruption leads to more mutations, and more mutations can actually lead to the development of cancer. The more mutations your cancer cell has, the more irregular it looks to your immune system. So the immune system is trained not to go attack normal body cells, otherwise we'd have bad autoimmune diseases in all of our bodies. But if the more irregular the cancer cell looks, the better able the immune cell is then to say, oh, I have a receptor on an immune cell that can recognize that cancer cell. And if that interaction exists, then the immune cell can go and kill the cancer cell. We have a variety of clinical trials available, and because they open and close all the time, and even if a trial is open, slots may or may not be available, and sometimes this changes on a day-to-day basis. I highly encourage patients to reach out to our nurse navigators and to us as physicians to find out what's available at any given moment in time. That said, a lot of our trials use different approaches. Some are immunotherapy trials, where we're trying to combine immunotherapy with some other agent to work in tumors where immunotherapy by itself has not been effective. So some of those are trials where we take traditional chemotherapy and add chemotherapy plus immunotherapy. Some are trials where we take a targeted agent that we think can help unleash the immune system. Sometimes that's a pill blocking a cancer-causing pathway. Sometimes that's a vaccine, like a flu vaccine type of vaccine, that's then given with the immunotherapy. And those are designed to try to retrain the immune system to attack those cancers. Cancer's unfortunately pretty smart. We're getting smarter, but the cancer cell usually still outsmarts us at some point. So even if we have a therapy that's working, the classic example is chemotherapy. Oftentimes we can't keep giving the chemotherapy indefinitely because of side effects, but sometimes we can. And when we can, usually the cancer cell eventually finds a way to grow with that chemotherapy. The idea is if you can kill 99% of the cancer cells with chemotherapy, that's great. But that 1% of cells eventually, sometimes on the order of months to years later, will eventually grow big enough to be visible on a scan, for example. And then we really need to switch therapies often to come up with something to target that resistant cell. And sometimes it's like playing a game of whack-a-mole where, you've killed the vast majority of cells, but that one cell that lingers pops up somewhere else. And so we have to keep thinking and recycling treatments to see what's best for the patient. At MedStar Georgetown University Hospital, we offer treatment for the whole patient in our pursuit of cura personalis. So it's not just treating the patient and their cancer, but it's treating their symptoms of their cancer, their side effects from their treatment, but also working with a cohesive group of docs to find what's best for the patient and their family.